Invite the people to stand. Put your hands together for the people. I didn't realize that Mommy was not to be outdone, so she tried a thing. Stand, Mommy. Hallelujah. God is amazing. God is amazing. Yeah, truly amazing. We continue. Last week we looked at what was the theme again? All the rehearsal. I can almost sit down. Can you imagine? Yes, what was the theme for last week's message? Get that. It's not just the nice, it's a thing, man. It's just, what kind of statement is that? That's a command. We call it imperative. So let's go. Tell yourself and then tell somebody else. Again? And you know when you're talking to yourself, you have to tell yourself twice. Amen. Amen. And so we want to continue along that same vein this week, just making a subtitle of that to the mind of Christ. Are we in for that this week? So we looked at that somewhat. We want to just explore the mind of Christ a little this week. And so I want you to follow me, to work with me. So we're going to start by playing a pretend game. What are we going to be doing? A pretend game. Is that okay? Do we all know how to pretend?
Yes, Auntie.
Are we in for the pretend game?
Yes, Auntie.
Okay, I know Samoya is. We need some more persons other than Samoya. Can't be just one person in the game. We all need to join in the game. So are you in for the pretend game?
Yes, Auntie.
Okay, so listen now. So, right where you're sitting, right where you are, the game has begun, right where you're at, you are having a holy visitation. What are you having? You are being told that a screenshot is now being taken of your mind. Alright, we know what a screenshot is. For those who don't understand screenshot, let's say a picture. You know, it's taken off your mind. All that's going on in your mind right now, a picture has been taken of that. And then, you were told that that was not the first screenshot that was taken. This is the second. A screenshot was taken of your mind all of last week. And the information collected will be placed on billboards in every parish capital across Jamaica. All the contents of your mind, last week up to today. And it's going to be your name, Ambassador of the Kingdom of Heaven, Lorraine Rainford. And you know those billboards that move, the light pretty one? And yes, they're in every parish capital. And your name and whatever, the city we're from, Kingdom of Heaven, is on it. And that is plain, right? It has been used as an evangelism tool to bring men back to Christ. Are we still in the game? Anybody wants to cry Cree? You know? So we're talking about the mind of Christ. And we have the mind of Christ. So I know it may be, some of us may have to see God afterwards, beg him to delete some stuff. You know, we have some who don't know deleting, have to use whiteouts and white out some stuff, cartridge paper, and put over some stuff. Isn't that so? As you check your mind, even your mind right now, you know, we realize that, the mind of Christ thing is a serious thing. Are we realizing that? But if whatever I just said should have been real, a screenshot should have been able to be taken of our minds at any time and made public to the world. So that is where we want to get. Is that our aim? That is the destination. We're at any time of the day, no matter what situation we're in until glory, and a screenshot is taken of our mind, it can be published. And it will do what we are supposed to do, the things that we want to look as though we're doing. You know, so we're kingdom ambassadors, and we will look like kingdom ambassadors. Our minds and our actions will be in the same place. Right? Now we're continuing the exercise. So the pretend game is finished. We're not pretending anymore. This is real game now. And what I want you to do We're going to be doing an evaluation of the state of our minds right now. Can we do that? So to do this mind, to do this task, all that is required is honesty. The thing is, you can't be honest because it's just between you and God, right? You will not be required to tell anybody what your answers are. You just need to know what the answers are. Is that okay? All right, and so let's look at the instructions. Let's read the instructions with me. Hold on, I'm not hearing this side. Is my hair coming again? Let's go. You're not seeing? Let's go. 1, 2.
Prayerfully study each item. Place a mental mark on each item in the center where you think you are today. If you incline toward the right or left, note where on the line you are.
Alright, so let me just explain that. We want all the children, everybody to be able to do the activity. So there. Coming up, the other slides will show you some stuff, and there's going to be a line, like this line, let's say this is a line between statements. So let's say this is one and this is one. You're going to look at the line, read what's on the left, what's on the right. Let's say what's on the left looks more like you. You're going to look on the line, and where's the left? Yes. Look on the line and see how close to the left you are, or wherever you fall along the line. So realize it's going to take serious knowing of yourself, serious honesty to do that. But it is very important that it be done. Can we do that? All right. So remember, it's a mental mark that you're placing on it. Nobody has to know what your mind is saying. Are we ready? Are we ready? Okay, there we go. So look at each item, that is each bullet point. Encourage the children beside you to make ensure that they're doing it. Are we okay with that slide? We need any more time. We can take all the time we need. Everybody understand what is happening? Okay, so Uncle Brownie, we're looking at that slide there. That line in the middle is very important, as well as the two things on the left and right. On the left, it says jealousy or envy. On the right, rejoicing the success of others. You're going to see where your mind is right at this moment. Not what we hope or what we were yesterday, right at this moment. So if you feel in your mind or in yourself, you know, that right now you're envious or jealous when others succeed or whatever, you may not be fully like way over close to it, but you may move a little bit to the center, like you're almost rejoicing for, you know, the success of others. Or if you're on the right, where you totally rejoice about the success of others, then that's where on the line you fall. If you rejoice sometime, but there's a little envy and a little jealousy, you understand? Then we're trying to see where we're at, where our mind is at, the condition of our mind at this time. Do you understand? Yes, and so we're doing that with all of them. So Uncle Brownie has given you a little bit more time. So he's doing this now, so he gets a little time to look again.
So
we must write under this. No, my mentor, just look. And you don't have to tell Uncle Lorraine, just keep it to you. It's your personal business.
us when you're done. Next. In, should the two words, station in life. Okay, but without respect for others. So we're explaining that point there below resentment. Pride in your station in life. Uncle Norris, explain that one for us.
It's if you have your social status, let's say for instance, let's say hypothetically speaking, I'm the manager for Westmoreland and Hanover of National Housing Trust. And because persons have to come to me to get a house, and a house is such a big investment, I think of myself as being important, and persons can't do without me, and so I just begin to think of myself much more highly than I ought to, and so probably after a while, if you don't treat me a certain way, I don't allow you to get a house, or I just begin to just feel so pompous and show off and boasting and all that and then some, simply because of the position I have.
Thank you. We need somebody else to do it for the flip side as well. Who wants to do the flip side of that?
You understand that everything that you are, everything that you have, comes from God. And at any moment, He can remove it all from you. And you are
Uncle gave that. So that is those who have. The memory of the haves and the haves nots. Oh. Yes, so give us one where they have nots. Because they know it happens and they have nots as well. Oh, I'm sorry. Oh. Yes.
So you don't have anything. You consider yourself, you don't have no house, you're living something that you don't like, and you don't have all the money you want to buy everything. And so, go ahead, Auntie.
Like we were talking earlier and saying that, you know, if you're going to rule with God, you must suffer. Then, like how I'm suffering, that must mean I rule it with God. Yes. So I'm better off than those who have money, because the rich will not enter.
Yes.
Oh.
Okay. Yes.
And so your state, whether plenty or little, becomes the barrier.
Could the flip side be explained as someone who has something, who don't have anything, but they're ashamed, full of pride to ask for stuff?
Yes, same way too. Yes, yes.
Yes, again, Auntie.
So you don't really have anything, but you're not begging nobody nothing. And you don't come to church because you don't have no clothes, you don't want nobody thinks so you come to church because I'm begging, you won't beg. You know nobody's sorry for you? That kind of. Yes. Or use it against you and stuff like that. Okay. We're done with that slide? Okay. No, man, you just need to check each one as you go. Yes, as you go. Yes, man.
One more.
you to know what resentment was. So resentment is when it is that you feel you've been treated badly or unfairly, and you are very bitter about it.
Say it tomorrow.
Rebellious against the food. That's an extreme.
But that's in feelings where it's...
You see, like you've been wronged. And you're just... And because you've been wronged, you just keep... That just makes you have... That's how you define everything. Everything comes from that place of being resentful. You've been hurt, and you resent it. You hate it. And you behave that way towards everything and everybody.
And when you see that thing, what causes resentment, when you see it, there is a your body responds. So you have a feeling, a down feeling comes over you, a tightening up. You just don't want to be in the same space as the thing or the person. Do we get that? Yes. Next. Which one, Auntie? Interesting.
I thought you were good looking down at others, and then the flip side would be thinking of others more better than yourself.
Which is God's word.
Yeah, but everybody there don't know that.
That's what we have on to Lori. Wonderful. Wonderful. And some more scriptures could come out of that. Some more words that would, when we look down on others, what would remind us? What is in the mind of God? That favorite one in Psalm. Yes? I am? And if I'm made that way, then the other person is. And yes, we're the head and not the tail. You know, and that's the word that affirms. So yours could have worked on it. It would definitely have been clearer for real. And since we have the Google Queen here today, we're going to ask her to Google and tell us the difference between indiscipline and undiscipline.
Yes.
So somebody told her we needed her last week? been well trained into it, aren't you? See what is to help you. Are you ready for us, Auntie? Okay. Go ahead, Auntie.
So, they are both nouns and both mean a lack of discipline. However, the word undiscipline is far less common than indiscipline. The latter can, okay. Don't tell me any major difference, Auntie. Four more common than undiscipline is an adjective. We'll look at something else. They don't know. All right. So indiscipline, when we often use the term indiscipline, that's true. It is a common term that we're accustomed to. Almost we think undiscipline is not even a word. You know? And so indiscipline, you know what discipline is. You can be disciplined, but you choose to do things that are not within the line of discipline. Right? So that is indiscipline. You express actions that are not within the line of discipline. Undiscipline now is where you are not subject to discipline or correction. So we see the difference? So you choose to discipline your children because you feel that they are indisciplined. Or we feel that they can be disciplined if they will follow through on the tenets. However, we know there's a place that we get where we refuse at all to be corrected, to be disciplined. We refuse to walk in that place. Do you understand that? Okay.
Tell me where I've lost you. I thought you'd finish up that sentence by saying, and so that is undiscipline. Is that what you mean to say?
And there's one more sentence first.
You said there is a place where you get to where you refuse.
Yes, that is undiscipline. Yes, that it is. Yes. So it's not allowing. You're not letting letting yourself undergo the process of discipline.
Yes, Andy, it's that means it's more like a rebellious person.
Rebellion, yes, yes. So you know it's a rebellion. Yes. Yeah. Are we done with that? Okay, next. Yes. Take that one for him, please. Break it down for him so he gets it real good. Do you understand Kadosh? Okay. Actually, ambition for self or family.
Go along.
last one is compromising.
Yes.
Compromising and faithful. The first one is headstrong and willing to yield.
Yes.
The one would think that compromising and willing to yield is not the same thing, but it's similar. And headstrong and faithful, because when you're faithful, to be headstrong in the right things is probably considered faithful. If it is that you're unyielding. So if you're unyielding in the right thing, that is probably a good thing. So therefore, I think, depending on how you look at it,
yes,
I'm wondering if compromising and headstrong, it's almost as if it is, well, for me, it could be seen as if, like, for instance, if I'm willing to yield, that means like some person would probably consider that to be compromising. And so therefore saying, no, you should not yield. You should hold your ground. But that I don't know if that could be considered headstrong as it relates to things that are right.
I get what you're saying.
So probably not nothing about that. But yeah. The person's understand. See, when we are saying that you must be willing to yield, but is willing to yield only to those things that are worth yielding to.
Yes.
There are some things that you should hold your ground and not compromise then. Or, well, if you understand it.
Yes. Okay. Do we get that?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. I don't understand the last one. You should put self-compromise and ambition for others. What's
who will take that one?
I'm just going for your move down. Back to the headstrong aspect. Because
hold on a minute, Adam, I'm not answering yours yet.
I was faced with a situation where it's a choice between right and what I ultimately deem as righteous. And I had to heal.
Interesting word, right and righteous.
I had to heal, and I knew I was right, and I could have remained headstrong. But like the teaching where we represent the kingdom and not ourselves, I had to look into that and just healed.
So we're looking at the
it's real that it's willing to heal is really the way to go. It's really the way to go.
Okay, so that's a flip on it as well.
Well.
As well.
I just have to be careful what it is.
Yes.
So Peter, alright? When he was being told, as far as the law is concerned, if you go out there, brethren, do not, praise the Lord. Brethren says, listen, should we listen to you or should we listen to the Lord? Well, I hope it doesn't come to that. But there may come a point in time where I'm being told to do something that will work. And I may have to choose to either do what I consider to be okay because work demands it, or because it is contrary to, and it's not just anything flipper, but it's something that is so paramount as far as God is concerned, I'm going to have to say no.
Yeah.
And I understand that in holding fast to my position, I'm going to lose a little work. But in those situations, and I pray God it doesn't come to that, but in those situations, I'm going to have to not yield. And so, I mean, but
as it says,
but you've been healing to God. Because you're healing to God.
Okay, this is nature, nurture.
Okay, cool.
Well, auntie,
which comes first, auntie, the egg or the chicken?
Auntie. I just believe the it's really uncle, I guess, the context in which the words are being written.
And I like that, the conversation. Because guess what? It means that we're thinking
interaction
and we're checking ourselves. So I'm going to ask two, or say this, ask the pastor or something. And then we're going to go back through the list, looking at it another way. So, Adam, yes, ask the question again, Adam. Adam wants to know the last point. Who was taking that? The last point there? You want that one that explained.
Ambitious to serve.
Yes. Who will take that? I see Pastor Brennan wanting to take it. Go ahead. Ambition, it should be, really. I'm sorry.
experienced church folks talk about pastor, Christmas, and everything about that. So ambition for family and self. Experiences. For example, with my son at the church I used to pastor. You know, like for example the food line, probably he would want to go first and something. I don't know, I changed all of that. I send the children first, but not necessarily him. You understand? So it's part of an example. He might feel offended by it. But what happened is that he was being withdrawn because you don't want to get into too much of that. And as a leader, or any kind of leader, whether a family man or a church or anywhere, you have to put others first in order to put God first. That's the idea behind it. And then ambition for others means the same thing. Putting God first. You put others before you. You understand? You lead so that others will follow, but you still get served. You understand what I'm saying? You still get served. And what James said. Remember, James was one of them who was very critical about certain things. And he tells us about patience and tolerance. We don't like that kind of vocabulary. It's not nice to us. But the other thing is that once you become the child of God, you have no rights. And the same thing, you have no ambition.
Okay, I know somebody else wants to say something as well. Who is that person?
Okay. And you know I'm using somebody as a quote that can't mind on already. All right. And I'm not saying no to that.
Yes.
And
that's a perspective.
That's
right.
And to an extent I agree. But some persons may be challenged with no ambition. And so it don't mean that you must be worthless and don't want to become anything in life. We should all aspire to become what God wants us to become. And so if some person, for instance, if the Lord wants me to become a doctor, then I should aspire to become a doctor because I'm fulfilling purpose. Some persons may define that as ambition. And then if that's it, then so be it. I just end up, so therefore, from that point of view, persons may struggle. And I'm saying, the Lord wants me to become a teacher, aspire to become a teacher, work hard to become a teacher. Just that though, what we aspire to do and to become, should, the Lord says, esteem the other more highly than myself. So what I should be concentrating on, what I should be spending my energies, is not to be making me better, not to be going after what is in my best interest, not what it is that I want, but I put that energy and interest in the other person. The truth is, Auntie, we all do that. Somebody
you
watching my back, I'm watching somebody back, and you know, we all just doing what it is that is in the best interest of the other person, and that is great. God will take care of what needs to be taken care of.
Auntie.
That's right. I want to add rights to it.
Yes.
Rights to the ambition, which is very delicate, but it's very, it's not sensitive, it's spiritual. I add rights to it because you don't have rights to the things of God if you don't believe other people should go for it. It's simple that. I add rights to it, rights.
Okay.
And ambition.
Yes.
It goes hand to hand to what God wants.
Yes, Pastor?
Apart, Auntie Laurie, no.
Overhand us first.
Auntie Laurie wants to say
that. So your voice, then Auntie's voice, I heard, then Auntie.
There's a verse that I've been using for devotion at Jabne for the last school year and into this school year. And it's 1 Corinthians 12:31 that says, strive for the best. Strive for the greatest and the best. But yet I show you a more excellent way. And I think fundamentally, What ambition for self does, it causes you to want to scrape always for you and family and not be mindful of each other, of the other person. Yet what God teaches that I show you a more excellent way,
and the more excellent way comes right back to this four-letter word, love.
Amen.
Yes, sir. Can we clap for
that? Amen. Go ahead. Thank you. Thank you, for this scripture, Uncle, because I was trying to figure out which scripture we were referring to. And so perhaps modification would be ambition only for self and family on this side.
Okay.
You know, so that scripture says, seek that way, but there is more.
Yes.
The more is the loving of everybody.
So that whatever I seek for, the greatest and the best that I seek for, will be. And as Uncle Norris put it, is not that we must have ambition to strive for good things and the best, but the motive for which to strive for it must always be for the greater good of human.
First Corinthians 12:31.
And then 1 Corinthians 13.
Yes.
So I was going to say something around that, but it's similar. There is a way that sometimes we need to strive for the best so that others will feel free to do the same thing.
Yes.
Because as Auntie said last week when she was talking, she said that our heroes, they went there, you know? They went out there and they pushed. And yes, they could have gotten caught up in the fact that they're on the limelight and nobody's looking at them. But they were doing it. And they were pushing, they were ambitious for the freedom of everybody.
Yes.
And there's a certain way that when it is that we pursue what God has given us, we make the way clear for other people to do it too.
Yes.
If she does it, I can do it too.
Yes.
So we make the way clear for other people to do it as well. So yes, the ambition only certain is, isn't it? But at the same time, go for what God has put in your heart to do, to make the way for other people who may feel. Because very often what God gives us to do feels impossible to be done. And so we may have what we think are impossible thoughts or dreams inside of ourselves that God has put there. And when it is that others of us go after that which God has given us, listening to Him, being led by Him, and getting it done, it frees others to do the same thing.
Amen.
Amen. Do you like the condition of your mind based on the litmus test? You don't have to nod your head or anything. Just smile and, you know, put on that face that nobody can read. Okay, remember, that's your business. Just you deal with it. Do you like the condition of your mind based on what you just did? And there's a quick follow-up question. Would God like the state of your mind right now? So those are the two questions that we need to answer at some point today, right? We're going to go back quickly and we're going to look at the entire list. And probably you might realize that there are two minds up there. Do we see that?
Yes.
Can you see the mind of God?
Yes.
Can you see our mind?
Yes.
Okay, so let us go through the things that are the mind of the flesh, the carnal mind. So let's read all of those things. Let's go.
Jealousy, envy, wanting to get even, bitterness towards God, bitterness towards others, sexual lust for position and power, hatred for someone, anger, resentment, pride in your station in life, pride in your ability to rule, looking down on others, self-love, self-seeking, slandering others, reliance on self, boasting, unthankful to God, lazy, undisciplined, headstrong, addicted to TV, hunger for the things of the world, combative, contentious, compromising, ambition for self often.
And let's hear the mind of God. Let's go.
Willing to
start from the bottom up. Sorry.
Ambition for others. Yielding personal rights. Hunger for God. Devoted to prayer. Willing to yield to. Discipline. Hard working. Always thankful to God. Achieve. Rest on God. Encouraging others, seeking the kingdom, selfless love for others, reverence for others,
not self-centered,
humility for others. giving, be peaceful, love enemy, humility towards others,
holiness towards, generosity towards others,
accepting God's will, praying for any,
rejoicing.
It sounds like two different lines. Does that sound the same way to you? I can hear a great disparity between the two lines. Did you hear that?
Yes.
And as we would have done that little assessment there, we would see wherever we're at in any little shape, any point there, whether we're like what we're seeing, the disparity, way over there, in the middle, a little bit too much over here, not far enough over here. Were we able to see that?
Yes.
That where we're at, right? So the aim is that whatever is there, that we realize that we're too much on the left, what do we need to do?
Make the adjustment.
What if we're in the middle?
Make the adjustment.
What if we're, you know, halfway on the right?
Make the adjustment.
Yes, we have to make the adjustment. We must go fully over because we're going for the mind of Christ. We're going for the mind of Christ. So this disparity between our mind and God's mind, a scripture came to mind. Not, it can fit in, I'm going to make it fit in into this, right? So that scripture that speaks about as far as the heavens
are above
the earth.
So far
are, let us quote it properly. My thoughts are not
your thoughts.
My ways and as far as the heavens are from the earth, so are my thoughts and my ways from your thoughts and your ways. Have you ever thought about how far heaven and earth is? So we just want to put into perspective what we're talking about. The mind of God and the carnal mind. So it's my mind. He said his thoughts, which is mine, is different, far from heaven to earth. So I decided to do a little research to see, because I know that nobody's really right where this is concerned. Don't you think so? No scientist can know for sure. But I'll go with whatever they say, since they would have done it. I don't know that it's going to mean much to us, because I don't even know if we understand what one mind looks like. Can we naturally judge what a man is? Maybe not. So it may not even mean much to us, but maybe the number may be, you know? So it is 33.968 trillion miles.
It's farther than from here to south.
It's proper far.
Do we get that? It is far. It is what? Far. We can't miss a one far. Far.
It is proper far.
Properly far. Do we realize that? So we're talking about the mind over there and the mind over here. That's a distance. Far. Now, do you know that we can be born again, living in the kingdom, and that far in our mind as it relates to where Christ is, and can live and die that way?
Lord have mercy.
Yes, can live and die that way. So that frightens me. And then when I realize how far, because then I realize I've been in the middle, you're not even anywhere yet. So from earth to heaven, be in the middle, you don't reach heaven yet. You ever see that? It's almost like it's easier to drop back on earth. It don't look so. Yes, so I'm like, oh my God, it is far. Very, very far. But back to the context of how that scripture, sometimes I'm going to push it in, let it work. Back to the context of that particular scripture about far, how far the mind of God is from ours. He was talking about? Isaiah 55:8. He was talking about forgiveness, you know. And was that one of the things up there? Forgiveness. That our mind towards forgiveness. And his mind and thoughts towards forgiveness. Yes, we have big issues with it. Because when we forgive, give just a little bit, we feel like we have done the long distance forgiveness. Isn't that so? And so he's just one point he's putting. Not to mention like our love. Can we see the distance in God's mind for love and ours? And if we begin to name the things, we never get out here today. Right? So we're understanding. And so Philippians 2:5. We've been in Philippians for a while. It says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. And like I said, once, well, I'll preach for Uncle Norris because he missed the first part of the worship. But this was done already. So, those of you, it's a refresher course. For Uncle, it's new. So what is the objective really of this verse? Do we know it was in worship? It was a big word in the verse Uncle used. It was in brackets, it was set again at the bottom of the verse. Humility. The objective of this verse now is humility. So when I saw you started there, I'm like, wow. Right here on the start, that's where you started. You know? So the objective is humility. Let's read the scripture again with that in mind. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Go back to the list of stuff and realize that if that spirit of humility is perfected in us, then the left side business won't affect us that much or at all. Are we realizing that? Because a lot of the things on the left side is because of the lack of humility.
Yeah, feeling. Yep.
And so humility is what this thing is all about. And if we should really read probably about from verse 2 to about verse 8 of this. Somebody wants to read it for me? From about verse 2 to verse 8 of this thing. The hand is up there, auntie. It's like you missed the opportunity. We'll take the hand.
We're at Philippians 2, right?
Yes.
Philippians 2, verse 2. Then complete my joy by having a common purpose and a common love, by being one in heart and mind. Do not do anything out of rivalry or vanity, but in humility, regard each other as better than yourself. Look out for each other's interests and not just for your own. Let your attitude towards one another be governed by your being in union with Christ, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be possessed by force. On the contrary, he emptied himself in that he took the form of a slave by becoming like human beings are. And when he appeared as a human being, he humbled himself still more by becoming obedient even to death. Death on the stake as a criminal. Therefore, God raised him to the highest place and gave him the name above every name. That in the honor of the name Yeshua, every knee will bow in heaven, on earth, and under the earth, and every tongue will acknowledge that Yeshua is Messiah, is the Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
I know that reverberates in every heart in a different way.
Yes.
It's the same guitar, but on a different string. You know, but it is the same message.
Amen.
That is, did you not just feel that?
Amen.
Did you know, this is what we're talking about, that let this mind be in us, this humility. Did we hear? I don't know that we heard on you, but your voice, give it back to her. Her voice helps us to hear it in a particular way. Let us listen to it again.
Then complete my joy by having a common purpose and a common love, by being one in heart and in mind. Do nothing out of rivalry or vanity, but in humility, regard each other as better than yourself.
Hey.
Look out for each other's interests and not just for your own. Let your attitude towards one another be governed by your being in union with Christ. Though he was in the form of God, he did not regard equality with God something to be possessed by force. On the contrary, he emptied himself in that he took the form of a slave by becoming like human beings are. And when he appeared as a human being, he humbled himself still more.
Can we put into perspective now this side of the things over here, understanding them, not to be talking about us, but to be talking about the mind of Christ. So let's look at the yielding and the faithful. And can we see them coming out of this?
Yes.
Yes. So we see that coming out where he is everything. He has everything. But for us, can we describe us? Can we describe the state we're in when he made this kind of decision? I want us to think about that. I don't want us to see the pretty us now. This, just look at the state we were in when this kind of decision was made by Christ. Who were we?
Liars.
Who were we?
Biters.
All, everything over there. Bitter. All of those stuff. Angry. Wicked. Moving against each other in serious ways. Can you see that? And in those ways, murderers even, huh? Because you know the scripture says that if you slander your brother, you are just like the murderer. And it says if you look at the woman, you have already committed adultery. If you lust. So we're talking about that kind of place. And so, you know, some of us, or most of us, if not all of us, would do good things. Would put down who we are, our person, our everything, our money, our time, name the things that are important to us, that makes us important.
Amen.
Name some of those stuff. Our job title, our, come on guys, let's try to find them. Accounts,
material,
house,
material,
your clothes, your shoes, name them. Your pretty utensils, your family, yes, your career,
our makeup,
your me time,
our makeup.
That's more important to me. My me time is more important than my bank account. To me. You understand? That's very important to me. Your spouse, your guitar. Come on, guys, I want to find the things that are important to you. Like Jakeem's belly, I know that is very important to him. You know, we're talking about the Kadosh, what's important to you.
What's
delicious makeup kit. What's important to you? Your friends. I want us. Your health. Yes. So we have things, you know. Well, the Lord has tremendous ways of working things. Because the truth is, her makeup kit was almost as big as her handbag, if not bigger. And that was very important to her. But guess what? She went all the way to Portland. And the Lord relieved her of that burden. As somebody broke in the car and stole all the makeup kit. Some of the things were in the car and they took the makeup kit to them. So you know that so we can see through this that God can remove the things. Oh my God, God is amazing. But we were in states like those. And God, that one we're pretty like how we feel right now, right? Came down. Humbled himself, gave it all up for our rescue so that we can become somebody. We're now being pulled into having the mind of Christ. This kind of humility, Auntie Carly, where all the people that we so turn our nose upon, that we so dislike, that we, because we're Christian, we don't really dislike them, but we dislike their attitude. We dislike the things they do. Come on. Huh? We dislike how they go about things. That's all. He's saying that he's calling us into this kind of fellowship and agreement where we will put down all those nice stuff that we just mentioned to go after them the way he came after us. Is that possible?
Yes.
Is that possible?
Yes.
How, when you came into that revelation that Jesus did all he did for you, what did you do? And let me fix it, because the truth is, a lot of us don't really have like real conversion. You know, it's long time along the path of being converted you realize what it means. Not true. Because some of us were just running away from the burning fire. So it had nothing to do with what Jesus did. It's just not wanting to be in the burning fire. And once you escape the burning fire, that was fine. So it's like way along the road, when you were able to now appropriate what Jesus did for you, then you became really grateful. So what if we can appropriate this to this life, that life, your life, And then we go after the world the way Jesus came after us.
Yeah.
What do we think we will have? What do we think we'll have? We have to know enough, because that's why we're here. That's why we're kingdom people. So we have to see it. Because, uncle, if we don't see it, because guess what? God saw me today. In the midst of my mess, he saw me today. And it was worth going after. So we must at least be able to see what is going to happen, because that is going to be a part of what is going to push us to put down to go. So if we can't see anything, if we can't imagine anything, if we can't know anything, then we won't be pushed at all. So I want every one of us to begin to see right here. Force yourself to see what it will look like. See what somebody who has a propensity to molest babies, like 6 months old babies. See what that looks like if you are the one who should chase that person, who should lay all down for that person, and they respond to salvation the way you have. And then get their minds renewed and can go after some more of their kind. How does that look?
Looks like Dane.
Yes, Auntie. If you can look at yourself and you can say, you know, put yourself in your shoes and say, you know, I was once out here like them. We might not do the same thing, but even probably worse. And God.
Yes. And I like what he says, though, because that's a barrier for us.
Yes.
Because we have never held a gun. We don't feel that we're such a sinner. Because you weren't promiscuous before you got saved, you don't feel that you did anything bad. You know, because you weren't a drug addict, you don't feel that, you know, you weren't that bad. You were like them. We don't feel that way. But you know what I always say to Lori? It's only because I was a coward why I never do what they did. They brave. I could get up and do it. But in my mind, I would have done that 50 times and in more vicious ways. Isn't that true? Yes. They were brave. I got up and did it. But we're cowards. We sit down and have it in the mind.
Yes.
And so we find ourselves even rejoicing when somebody else does it.
Yes.
It's a good thing. Long time, that what we said, bucket going to well, one day the bottom must come out. And then the Holy Spirit just remind you, you're a Christian now. And you say, well, just judgments. We don't even stop it when the Lord tried to stop us. We push for judgments. The day of vengeance. Oh my God, yes, okay.
Part of the issue is how we define sin and how we define value or valuable. So because there is a gradation or some kind of grade to sin, then some sin is bigger or smaller or whatever. So therefore, so you are deemed to be sinful or bad or vicious depending on the sin you commit. No, it would seem as if value for God has less to do with what you do or your sin, and value to God, that God considers people valuable, and just seem to have nothing to do with their sin.
Okay.
So his effort of going after somebody who's a child molester seems to be the same effort as somebody who is lustful, or somebody who there seems to be no distinction. Or
so
now
I can assure Uncle.
Huh?
You say it seems to be the same.
No. To God, it is the same. And so it's the mind that you're telling us about, the mind of Christ.
Yes.
We must get to the place where we stop defining people based on their level of sin.
Yes.
And we see the value in them.
Yes.
That the Lord sees.
Yes.
No, that's the part that can help me to understand.
Yes.
He looks at anybody and everybody, and they are to him precious.
Yes.
And so he goes after them. So therefore, help me to see the value that he places on people. And so therefore, because I'm thinking, if we begin to see the value that he sees in them, then we'll be able to see past what they do, see them for who they are, and then pursue them because of who.
And the reason they were created.
That's right.
You understand? So we that woman thing on that side that says, looking down on others, would have no need to look down on others. If we, I see your hand, if we realize that in God's lab,
that's right,
the measurement for sin is set.
That's right.
It has one weight. It doesn't matter what goes on it, whether a fly or a compass bag of stuff. It's just one weight. So sin is just sin.
That's right.
Once it's sin, it goes in this space and it has the same
effect.
The wages of sin is death. The gift of God is eternal life. Whatever is just a sin. So as Uncle says, what we as kingdom people who are called to the ministry of reconciliation must see is the life,
that's right,
the possibility,
that's right,
of that life with Christ.
Life,
the what? The possibility of that life. When you see a guy on stage going on and going on, see that guy worshiping God instead of doing what he's doing. See that guy. When I hear a man cussing bad word, I'm like, man, imagine how that one would suit Uncle Kirk. Would shout hallelujah and Jesus would hide me. So we see the value in them, and because we see the value in them, we'll go after them. We will go after them. Auntie Gloria. That's right.
Let me clap for Gloria.
Indeed. So we have been given a very high... Oh, I have to pause to take Abba Joy. Go ahead.
When in the Bible it says that... When in the Bible it says that disobedience is a sin of witchcraft, it's not really comparing, right? Because is it said in the context... Was it put in the Bible to show those that think that their little sin is nothing, to show that it's just as bad?
Yes, yes. Because he was talking to that king there. Remember Samuel?
Yes.
And
Saul.
And Saul. And so Saul didn't... Saul was making light of what he did. That he wasn't somebody. Only, you know, he did most of what God said he should have done. He only didn't do a little bit. So he couldn't see why God just go on so. You know, God said do this, and he even went out of his way to search out the flock and take out the best. Yes, yes, and he's going to make a sacrifice to God. So he couldn't see what could be so off about that. But that wasn't the mind of Christ.
Uncle B,
the hand up.
Alright, normally when me at work, if a person comes in a vehicle and I behave a certain way, I'm going to tell them to stop. It happened to me a couple of times, I'm going to turn back and I'm going to put them on because it was the park. But going on the road, if the situation starts, we can't put them on again because they're going to have a problem, we take them out of the vehicle and it happened to them. So we can't tell them to come, we have to just go on the situation. So, like, yeah, it's straight away. If a person comes in the car and I want to start, cause something nasty about it. Even kids in care of other people. Because it's going to happen to this week. No, we can't remove it. Because if you're remote, then you're going to have a problem. Why would you listen to it?
Look, are we learning something from what you said? So let us learn that. So it's against the law for him to put out a passenger.
Because even he's in care, so we have witness to him.
Yes.
The other day, we have to go. And you have to listen, we feel that we're going to go. And the situation is a legal person, it hurt. Because a pastor lady eventually wanted something. So she started cussing every Christian. And I said, because when you hear God's message, that face, oh, you're a Christian. And he started giving me...
Go back to the word you're asking me about. Resentment.
He started giving me. And you know, from that, he did for me hard. And if you sit down here, say, you know, some people talk to me first, can't get me to understand. Say, even the person said, I said, you smell a lot of passion. You have an influence.
Yes.
And when she said, I said, come on, that vehicle, I'm by the wheel, let's put it in. And he just said, me stop and leave the other day and he looked for me and my laugh. And he said, see you. So he know what she know what she did.
Yes.
She mean it, she see me, she did. She started laughing. And then if she remember me, I know who me be. But he said, me never ask you. have the ear. True, but through the ring of me, I thought, no. If me then go back to that person and then start talking to her, or someone will be able to talk to her.
Yes, it is indeed imperative. Yes, important.
Just leave it on me still and just go on.
If there are problems in the car,
actually, I say, but the listen, he says, if the person coming up here, say, who am I money two times then? The third time, I have a reimbursement because I'm going to come with the same thing. So, how am I handling the situation, Andy?
Wait, which of the situations?
The bad word causing, the hip labor.
All right, so of course.
I misbehaved it then.
All right, so. You are the authority in your car,
right?
And somebody comes in, it is okay to pull off the road. So you're not going to do it whilst you're driving, because remember, that is another business again. So you're going to pull off the road, and you're going to nicely say to the person, I understand you might be hurt or whatever. I'm going to ask you, please, you're free to express yourself, but please respect the other passengers in the car. If you'd like me to step out with you and talk to me alone, I could do that, but... please respect the other passengers in the car. They might comply, and they may not comply.
But
you would have said something, whether they comply. Because sometimes, what was said, the undisciplined and the indisciplined, sometimes they hear, and sometimes they're too embarrassed to stop. And they feel that, they must be seen as this kind of, front. So they will continue, but the word is working on their hearts. So that time may just be the last of the words they're using. They won't do it again. But the thing is to say something.
It has here to do with righteousness. It has here to do with right and righteousness. It is in his right to say something, but righteousness dictates that you cannot go all the way, like come dry mode, push mode, that sort of thing. Is always a way. And words is the most powerful thing that you can use. Calmly, comes back to humility. The way you say these words is very important. And if he knows that he also is upset, he cannot approach the situation then. Maybe down the road when he gets calmer, he could say anything. So there's a lot of factors right there. You understand me? Oh, this man from the vehicle and behave himself, whatever. But you have to push past all of that.
And see the God in them. Because remember, I remember one preacher said, when we see people behaving like that, they are crying out for help.
Yes.
A lot of time they're crying out for help, but we're so caught up in. Yes.
And it was a mystery that answer, Mr. Blow answered when we began to talk to the person.
Yes. And I think the place is open. The fact that the person has seen you after. And this will come in smile.
Yeah. If you say to the person, I don't say yes, the person is bothered. Because then the person may have to see all the while, and she has to see, but we never really talk. So she basically she knows me.
Yes, so that is a door open for you.
There's one part of the story that we haven't yet qualified.
The money part? Yes, qualify that, Uncle Norris.
No,
oh, yes, what did you do with the substance?
No, when, because,
was it? Don't you're stuttering, bro.
No,
you're stuttering.
I did, like, passing the end. It's the next girl, if he doesn't look safe. See, like, how we here. I'm just trying to see, I'm seeing grab it.
Oh,
you remember, the next girl behind me beside
her. I didn't get that, like, I got that it was left in.
No, man, no,
of
no,
the
no,
seat.
Never leave it.
Okay.
No, never leave it.
But, it was on the purpose.
No.
Yes.
So about the whole toxic thing, it's important to always not cow down and not speak based on your beliefs. Because sometimes we're afraid that we don't want to, but if you want to go, there is toxic to stop all time. And he had some foam schoolgirls in there, and he was going on some nasty arguments. So I went to the schoolgirls, and I spoke to them. I said, you can't do that. Other people are in the taxi, and I don't want to hear those things. I'm going to stop. They asked him to let me out. I spoke to my boss. Some person, I don't have big people in here. If you don't care, don't ever care again. Down there, and of course, argument stopped. All the girls started to look at me, and they're looking around at me because I was in the front, and he stopped, he didn't say anything else. And all of them was going to stop, and he blew and he stopped, and he realized it was him. And I went to the car, into the room, and he said, oh, I Christian teach, what's your music? Remember, the first time I put him, but I'm gone, I talking to my name's Juan, I'm going, I'm just sitting down, and I never said anything. I came, I said, thank you, and I read stuff, and I come out of his car. And the next time he saw me, the urban changed the CD, quick. So them song, you know them song lyrics from Mama Days, the six man bringing you back to the preacher. Yeah. 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 Ye
him and he realizes that I will not
worship.
So always speak out. Don't ever be afraid to speak out. Is your belief on your God?
They hear.
Yes, they do. They hear every single thing.
And when one of the reasons why we might not speak, or one of the reasons why we would not speak out is because we fear what the response is going to be. So once we speak out, it's going to perhaps be hurtful, harmful to you and how you feel and all the things. But guess what? Something would have been said. The word would have gone into the person. And they're going to respond to you differently.
Yes.
And you can sow.
Yes.
And you sow seeds that you don't even know. You know that? Yes. Guys, this mouth isn't powerful here. If we use our mouth and use the mind of Christ. So when we see Christ going about, he dealt with people. Don't you saw that?
Yes.
I remember, we're in a taxi. And everybody just came out and we're going downtown. And the man stopped and bought himself a cup of soup. And came back in. He said, beg you a minute, ladies. And bought a cup of soup and he came back in. And I said, my God, you look like such a nice looking man. So mean, you want two ladies to carry by yourself a cup of soup and go.
You
said
that?
Yes. That's not a mean man. He looks so nice. And you went to buy one cup of soup. You said, me not mean as a lady. And him look at us. But I don't like to be shaming. So apart from how we look, if he offered us the cup of soup, we'd say no. So he realized that. So he understands. So, so there was something in him. So he said, no, everybody not like that. You stopped to buy a soup. Ask me then. Let me say no. But at least I would know that you're a kind man, but I'm leaving the impression that you're mean. You know, and he didn't want me to leave with that impression.
Please say it again that you said it, because everybody thinks it's me, yes?
Well, I said it.
Yes, she, not me.
I said it.
Very bold, yeah?
Yes. So, we have been given a very high example, right, with the scripture that we have been reading here from Philippians. We can see where Jesus left his state of inexpressible glory. Amen. I mean, I don't know that you can express that. I don't know that any one of us here is eloquent enough. I don't think eloquence can do it. I don't think so. You understand? And he left that. We just know it's glorious. And it doesn't even mean anything to us when we say it's glorious. Does it? You begin to try to think. When you say glorious, auntie, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? Red carpet. Can you imagine? And somebody else who has a little bit more experience probably said, no. Answer something else.
I thought the
power he had. But what's that, auntie?
You know, auntie, if you read about it, you think about Superman, you think about all those people.
Oh, you see, like Shaquille O'Neal.
Powers, you know? And all that he could have done. You know, we read about all that he could have done. You know what I thought about Hebrews 12, where they said he suffered that at the mouth of evil men. You know, when people would say things about him and make all kind of, you know, suppositions and say, oh, him is a devil and how him. And
yes.
Here he was taking all of that and he could have just.
Is that lightning must come out of his shoulder?
You
want to see this? Yes! Oh my God, his ways are higher than our ways, isn't it? No, I wonder if we really get it. You know?
With all of the saying, you know, what we must now ask ourselves as individuals. We have the determination to go after one person. Because if we look, some of us were out in sin for 20 odd years, 30 odd years, and Jesus still was stretching his hand, saying, come. And some of us we talk to a person for 1 minute we get fed up.
Come on. Seriously. I said,
I'm God. Who are us to determine that?
Oh, what mind do we have there? Our mind.
They can't determine that. Mm-hmm. We must ask ourselves.
Come on, guys, let's do it.
We are determined.
Am I determined? Am I that determined?
to go after a soul the way Jesus Christ would have done it. Am I that determined?
Yes.
Because he needed time as well for what went in before to be assimilated. He needed to understand something. Have mercy on this child, Lord. So he left that inexpressible glory and he took on himself humanity. Humble form of humanity. Do we understand? I want us to, okay, good. Thank God for this. This is working as, this is in my ideal teaching chart. It does many things. It's why I like charts. They can do everything. So he, look over here, the great God, because all of these things seems far-fetched, don't? And he took on him humble humanity. What are some of those stuff?
Jealousy,
bitterness, all this stuff over there, the sexual lust, and all of those stuff. He left paradise and come take on
the
that.
Splendor.
Can you imagine? No, I don't want us to imagine, because I don't think we're imagining. Yes, the Bible.
Yeah. If you look, no, but I mean, without intention.
If you look at the person and intentions cross your mind, like you look at her, is the abortion nice?
No, in what sense? I mean, nice as in.
Like how men know that you know women nice.
Play it out in your mind. No, because of the shadow. Let's look at this. She's looking nice.
No,
I mean, not with any intention.
No,
You're not following the conversation, so let's have the law. Even if you can't have it, but you still desire it. So you look at her, or and it's a boy.
No, because you actually is what you actually said.
Yes.
Because you maybe just look at someone.
Yes.
So I mean, I wasn't clear on that.
Okay. So you get it now?
Right.
Okay, good.
Okay,
so when you look.
Look, I understand what you're saying.
Yes.
But you have to, like, if you see somebody and they look good, like, person we know them. I mean, I would say to somebody.
But you will know that they look good and...
No, man, just say, they look, let me tell them something like, when they look at it, look nice. Yes.
That's a compliment.
That's a compliment.
That's a compliment. You know, because the truth is enough. You can tell me that I look good, but you have to know what else is in your mind.
No, nothing about Christ in mind. Just tell
you. You understand? So that is why it is... Yes. Complimenting, as a matter of fact, is one of the better ways to keep yourself out of lust in. You know?
Michael, I'm not... All... To the Lord, we put a premium on what is done or doing.
Yes.
The Lord puts a premium on your state of mind. So you don't have to care because almost everything, or probably everything about us,
at the state of being rushed up by Lord Lemon. Most thing about us, probably not everything, comes from here, the
yes.
state of mind.
Yes.
So your state of mind is in the appropriate place or is renewed.
There you go.
And what flows from that state of mind is newness of life.
There you go.
But if your state of mind is unregenerated or old man, then what flows from that? So what the Lord is saying, if it is that you have to wait on the act itself
yes.
to know that you are in a bad place, it's so far gone, it's like cancer. When you start seeing the lesions and so on, you know you're dead even tomorrow or the
yes.
other day. But cancer begins long time
long
before
time.
That. Cancer would have taken root and start evidencing itself in the natural. So you know, somebody, you're soon dead then. So what Michael, what the Lord is saying is, listen man, your state of mind, way before you do any action, that is when you need to see sin. And you need to deal with it from that point in time. Because when sin has taken root, it leads to death. So if you start waiting until you start seeing the
action,
the
evidence of it.
You know, by then the sin has taken root.
Yes.
And is death afterwards. So therefore what we're saying is that look into your mind, your mental state, and
yes.
start addressing the thing from there. So because everything begins from that place.
Yes.
Alright?
The Old Testament and the New Testament, simply. The Old Testament has something to do with the performance of the act. But in the New Testament, under grace, it is looking and thinking
prevention.
As in the perception, the thought. Totally different. But it's the same thing.
Amen. Everybody's clear?
Yes.
All right, so he came and he took on this form of humanity. And then not only that, he further went on to perform the most lowly office that could ever be. So it's not just like coming and stopping like a part of the way. He went the full way. For what? To benefit us. For our benefit. He had nothing to gain in us. Because as far as I'm concerned, he could have done away with this creation and just create a new one. I just don't want to put back the tree of good and evil. You don't think he could have done that?
Yes.
Of course, just do away. Just like when somebody offended on Facebook, you just block them. You just do away. WhatsApp, you just block. You just do away. You could just block us. We could be on this planet and other planets going on with life that we only dream of getting because we're banished from there. And we don't.
We cannot realize that. He don't need any of us. He's God all by himself.
Yes.
He don't need any of us. We need him.
Yes.
And that's what we must acknowledge. That we need him.
And he's forcing himself upon us to make us want him. Can you imagine? He's forcing himself upon us. What words we use? Yes, sponging upon. What words we use when people forcing up?
Push up.
Exing up himself. Exing up. Upon us. Push upon us. Stalking us.
No, thirsty.
Yes.
But why the word? Why?
Wait, Auntie, let's answer that why. Why is he doing all of that? That's what you're answering?
Yes.
Go ahead.
So as, you know, one of the things that came up, there it is, accepting God's will. And what he wants. We could have just figured out, say, it would have simpler if we did block. But he has a plan that is
yes.
so much higher, bigger, wider than us.
Yes.
That has the angels wondering, why bothering with these people? But if you are able to take a speck of dirt and make it into something big, great, and amazing, then that's an amazing feat, other than you take a diamond or cut a ready and say, all right, let me put it in a ring. But if you just take a piece of coal and make that great,
wow,
then it's going to be it's going to be something to look at.
Yes.
So the Lord, you don't want to start with the end.
No.
And just make it perfect and set it up. No, it's going to start with dirt and then make that perfect. So that his name will be glorified. If we were perfect already, there'd be no glory.
No glory, yes.
He has to get the glory. So we have to come from dirt to to something.
Wow. A thought just crossed my mind. I've never done any studies on it. It just crossed my mind. Can I share it? I'm wondering if it's that trick Satan. Because, you know, men, what Adam and Eve did, and, you know, he didn't block them. And so he thought that, you know, maybe he can go up there and try a thing. Because we would have a second chance. Like, you know, understand? So we recognize that Satan and his army, they were kicked out of heaven. And we in our state, heaven is prepared for us to enjoy. But what a thingy. What a thing. No wonder the devil cannot like us. Will not like us. Do we understand that? He will not like you, Auntie Marsha. He's against everything that you stand for. He's against everything perfect and beautiful that God sees in you. Do we understand that? He's against all of those stuff. And so, in the Arabic version, this scripture here in Philippians reads, let that humility be in you. Looks like that's what Uncle Kirk found. Because he had that in the end of it. Let that humility that we're talking about of Christ be in us. What let means?
Allow.
So what is he saying? We must do what? Allow the humility of Christ to be in us. Can we do that?
Yes.
Of course. What do we have to do that? What word do we stand on? What belief do we stand on? What is there that tells us that we can do that? We can do all things, but there's something that we learned in that scripture last week. We have what? What lives in us? The Holy Spirit indwells us. The Holy Spirit indwells us. And because that happens, we can do it. We can live. We can let the Holy Spirit, we can let humility indwell us, live in us, become us, become who we are.
When they decided to turn away from God, that was it.
That was it for them.
Okay.
Write it down. Don't lose it.
The thing was that they see the glory of God every day, but they rather that they wanted it. So unlike us who have not seen God, they see the power and glory of God, but rejected it. So we're not as, so they're more at fault than we are, because we have a greater faith than they did, since we believe in a God that we can see, while they see the power of God, but rejected it.
They decided to challenge it. That's the point, Adam. Come on, Adam and Eva.
Another version read the same scripture and said, think ye the same thing as Jesus. Huh? Think ye the same thing as Jesus. Let the same spirit and mind, deportment, appear in you as in him. So the same mind, the same affection, the same conduct, the same everything of Jesus must be seen where?
In
me, in us. Is it possible? I asked again. Is it possible? Do you feel that it is possible?
Yes.
Do you know that it is possible?
Yes.
We know it is not easy to decide, to determine, to put down the things that would render it impossible. But it is. We can if we want to, not true? We definitely can if we want to. Right? And so, this humility includes God's love for people. It includes what? God's love for people. This humility includes God's love for people. Everything that we're going to do as believers, every victorious action that we're going to take, every revival that we're willing to find is going to stem for our love for people.
Amen.
That love that God has for people.
Amen.
Every time we're going to pray 24 hours and when we realize there's no breakthrough, we go one more hour. And we said, we're going to go one more hour because I don't see the change. And one more hour to be realized we're doing it for 1 whole month and 2 months and a year. That is love.
Yes.
That is what? Love.
Amen.
That is what I want. I don't know about you, but that is what I want. Because I know, Auntie, that after I go good, focused, concentrated in prayer for a good 30 minutes, after that, I begin to...
Yes.
Anybody else? Or is me one? 30 minutes, fully engaged, fully focused. But after that, you have to begin to make yourself know that you're praying still. All somewhere along the line, you'll stop and forget and it's all an hour after. Jesus, I was praying. And you get back to it. I want. So, you realize there is a love that God has. Because I know at no point in my life he let upon me like that.
Amen.
What about you?
Amen.
He was consistent.
Yes.
He went after me.
Pursued
me.
Yes.
And that is what we're talking about. That mind, that love for people that God has. That he bore, and he bore this love from everlasting to everlasting. All time. So the resolution and determination of his mind became the consequence of it. So we could see. So the love he has produced action. Do you realize that?
Amen.
The love produced action. Say that again. So we're going back to the scripture. We're looking at the resolution and determination of his mind. Yes. You know? The consequences. So when there's that determination, and you use that word. When there's that determination, when we resolve in our hearts that this is why we're here. This is why we exist. This is the main reason that he has given me all the things he has given me.
Amen.
Do we know that?
Yes.
The blessing that he gives us is not so we can come testify. It's bigger than a testimony. It's so that we can be well equipped to do what he wants us to do. So everything about Jesus, it looked like him selfish. It sounds that way based on how we understand selfish. Because everything he does in us now is not about us. It's for him. All about him and for his glory. Do we realize that? All about him and his glory. So if we miss that, we'll think it's about us. So, okay, Auntie, you go home and you see something pinned up on your door, dead, cancelled, and you think it's about you. No, start, drop down and cry and say, Lord, what is it? Show me now. But we don't do that. We jump up and take up the phone, call unto Lori. Auntie Lori, guess what? Dead, cancelled. We do that for a whole week. And we haven't done one of the things that God wants. We never let them know how good God is to cancel death. We just know that death canceled. And when that is done, we don't know what it is that we were supposed to have done. Have you ever recognized that? So we believe that God blessing us is for us. We don't realize it's for them and him. Because they are going to experience his glory. They will know that he is God.
Mm.
His agreement with the Father, we're talking about the Son, the Spirit that we need to have. His agreement with Father to take upon him the nature of mankind. He went into an agreement. We have to agree with God. We have been saying that often, not true?
Yes.
We must agree with God. He agreed with God. And if we're following him, we must agree with God. He was what? God himself. And he put that down and learned how to agree with God. Not exalt himself. And you understand? He agreed with God to do what God wanted.
Amen.
So God decides, as we all know in John 3:16, to send his only begotten son. And the only begotten son never come down pushing up his mouth and kicking and cussing and said, "Man, Adam, can I use you?" Let me use Adam to make it real to us. So when Adam came back from the States, it was difficult for Adam to fit in. And not only Adam, all the children. Was especially Amber Joy. Was difficult to fit in because what? All Adam, all the buffet and those stuff were not available in Jamaica that Adam enjoyed overseas. And it was such a challenge. He left all of those to come back here for what? And so for about a year and a half, every time you talk with these children, what were they saying? When I was in America, I want to go back to America. When are we going back to America? So like for Amber, it took Amber one whole year to realize she was going back to America. So Amber just went through life until she realized she's going to do the GSAT. And then she realized, oh, and I'm going to America to start doing some work. So all the maths that she used to hate, she began to like it. Because you're not going back to America. At least not now. Do you understand? And so here we are. And Jesus said, he's sending his son, and his son agreed with him and come down here without any attitude to come. It's not like he knew he was coming to do something else. You know? He knew he was coming to die. And he came without attitude to come and die for some wicked people. He came to die for some thieves. He came to die for people who didn't even love themselves. Without just killing themselves, without even thinking about it. And he came to die for that. It was okay. So we must will ourselves to allow the mind of Christ to rule in our lives. What we must do? We have to will ourselves.
Yes.
So you're sitting down and you're listening. You have to will yourself that the mind of Christ is going to rule in your life. I can't make it happen for you.
No.
You have to will yourself. It's a personal decision that every one of us will have to take. That I am going to allow me, my mind, to become the mind of Christ. I'm going to pursue the things that I know occupy the mind of Christ. I must do what we learned last week. Starve this mind that I'm now functioning in. Because we realize that we got saved, but all that we did was put a plastic bag over our mind and it did not get wet. Yes. So we realize that we're going on and that the conflicts that we've been having in the mind because our minds have not been renewed because we have not allowed it. We have not willed ourselves to let it happen. Until Lorraine said on Friday night that the Lord would really love him to be Lord in all his might and glory. Just let your mind just work how he wants it to work. You know, but he's just standing back, being God, and just stand up back and watch us making the silly decisions.
Yeah,
uncle. He's God and just let. We really desire it, but we don't want to work to get it, let it happen. And he wouldn't even wave the wand and let it happen for us. Just work on that. Just, you know? No, he's saying, no, we have to do something. We must do something about it, Auntie Vanessa. We must do it. Can we do it?
Yes, we can.
Yes, we can do it. And we must do it if we want to be effective. If we even want to say that we're Christ. Because if we're Christ, we must have his DNA. And his mind is the thing that is going to set us apart and let us know that we are really his. Do we believe that?
Yes.
So, we must not think that the mind of Christ is to be a convenient sport. Because I know that from time to time, even the statement I made earlier, some person are like, really? I have the mind of Christ. Of course you do. But I can guarantee you, it's only in certain situations. So we turn it on and off, like it's light, we're conserving electricity. Isn't that how we utilize the mind of Christ? But the mind of Christ is to be possessed by a Christian. All the days of your lives, every conscious, unconscious moment, we must operate in the mind of Christ. So we can't turn it on now when we're in. We need a spiritual blessing. What are we going to do? Turn on the mind of Christ. And when we get the answer, we switch it off because we want to save it for the next time. We don't function like that sometimes? Yes. So when we find ourselves operating outside of the mind of Christ, it's because the mind of Christ in us has been switched off. Who switched it off? Yes. Christ does not do that. 1 Corinthians 2:16 says, who can know what is in the mind of the Lord? Who is able to advise him? But we have, I think I read from 15, but we have the mind of Christ. We do what? We have the mind of Christ. Say that with me. We have the mind of Christ. So every person, every believer, every true believer of the gospel, obtain this at your spiritual birth. Do we know that? So we obtain the mind of Christ at our spiritual birth. Then what is the problem? Similar to the development of children, you know, their minds must be developed, right? And if we, and if the time and the effort is not spent to develop the minds of children properly, what we know will happen to them?
They'll be retarded.
Tell us, you know, they'll be retarded, mental retardation. Can't matriculate. What else?
Cognitive.
They will grow big and look big and do things, but they will do it at a low level.
Abnormal
in some form or shape. So the very thing, so we have the mind of Christ, we obtain that at our spiritual birth, but what must happen? There must be growth and development.
Yes.
There must be stuff that are done to help us to develop the mind of Christ so it can be operant in our lives. So if all we have done, Uncle Norris, is just the receipt thereof and nothing about it, then what happened? We're going to be immature. Are we seeing that? So we have the mind of Christ. But this mind of Christ in us must mature. We need to understand that with this mind of Christ being Christian, you're still living in this present age. And this present age has what? Culture of all sorts. What else do we have? Politics of all sorts. Sports and music of all sorts. You're not helping me at all. Habits, established habits of all sorts. Reasonings of all sorts.
Norms
that, yes, of all sorts. Systems of all sorts.
Governments.
And go to talk about the spiritual wickedness and all those stuff. Those things are there. So with a mind that is immature, that we don't work, we don't firm up, we don't show up, what is going to happen when we encounter all of these things? Yes. We're going to be weak. We're not going to be capable to. We're going to succumb to the things on the left side.
Yes.
So the mind of Christ matures in the process of our growth. And how do we do that? What are the things we do to mature this mind of Christ in us?
Word.
We achieve this by the choices we make. So we can't just say the word. Because encounter with the word is a choice. So we have to go back to the beginning. It's going to be what? A choice. So we have to choose to, and I'm not using reading the word today. We have to choose to study the word. We have to do what? Choose to study the word. Because tell you what, it's a whole heap of book I read and I don't understand enough. I remember in college I had to read, Auntie Roberta might have had that, where this reading course that they give us, you have to read a certain 100 pages and you have to document the pages you have read and whatever. I had to do that. And one only for reading the book, big. And a carry-home exam. So when you hear a take-home exam, you know it's very difficult. So from the pages you have read, the exams come from that. All in a read of the entire book, no question on the paper match anything from what you have read. You still have to research. And I'm like, good heavens. So you know me, I'm always looking shortcuts, right? So I decided to look at the questions and skim to find information about that before I read everything. And until I'm reading, I realize, all right, I have to do some research. And I'm researching and I'm doing this. And then I realize that, oh my God. When I'm finished and I'm trying to assess myself, what did I learn? Not one thing. I wasn't reading to learn anything. I was reading to finish the paper. So I can get the grade to pass the exam. And the truth is, that's what we do with our Bibles from time to time. Because we know
it's a right Christian thing to do to have your Bible without cobweb. You take it up and open it and you read verse 1 or whatever, or because you've been on one of the Bible study plan that you must read the Bible through for a year, and you read it through for a year. But what happens? So we're not talking about reading your Bible. We're talking about studying the Bible. Studying the Word. Because we're talking about what? Maturing the mind of Christ that is in us. And to do that, we have to study the Word. Just reading it, and anybody, if you have children at home, stand to read your Bible. They read it, and you can hear from anywhere you're at when it's shut. They want you to hear, so they're done. They put it down and gone. And they're reading somewhere that they've read several times, just that when you ask them what they've read, they can tell you.
We can know when they are studying. Because if a person is studying, they will ask you questions. And questions about things that they don't know. But they read, but they don't know. So you can acknowledge, okay, at least this one is studying, he wants to know.
So it is changing you. So when you study, you learn. Isn't that so?
Yes.
When you study, you learn. And when you learn, what is the hallmark of learning? It's supposed to change your behavior. What is the hallmark of learning? A change, a permanent, add that word, a permanent change in your behavior. So then now we can check ourselves to see if we're reading our Bibles. You know? Because there has to be a permanent change in our behavior. So we take in the right nutrients. To mature our minds, we must take in the right nutrients. We must make ourselves find it imperative to know Christ. We must make ourselves. Nobody should have to push us into that. We must know that it's important for us, what you just said, to know Christ. We must study the Word and wait on revelations. We must what? Wait on revelations.
Yeah.
Do how many persons know that this generation is dying from fresh revelations? We need fresh revelations.
Yes.
We need fresh, from the lack of fresh revelations. You understand? So God, so what we're still surviving of are the revelations of great men. Spurgeon, and name some of those great men. Allen and Sparks, and name some of them. Wigglesworth, and those who are flesh and blood men like we are. Who use the time, put away the time to study the Word, to stay before God, to hear Him, to have revelation that we are just regurgitating. How about us having fresh revelations for our nation, our culture, our time?
Amen.
It comes from studying the Word.
Yes.
A mere reading of it will not reveal that. It's studying the Word. And so if we're going to mature, because we're realizing that the mind of Christ is filled with His Word, there's no thought He has outside of the mandate, outside of the Word. Do we realize that?
Amen.
And so what we have to do, we have to commune with Him through prayer. Through what?
Prayer.
Through songs. Through meditation. Are we hearing that? We have to commune with Him. That's a personal, intimate relationship where we're constantly, so when we commune with Him, we must also constantly amuse ourselves within God. Yes. We must muse on God.
Yes.
We must what? Muse. So it's a constant musing. It's a what? Constant musing. The truth is, it's easier for Christians to amuse themselves with God rather than musing upon God. I see that time. I'm coming. Rather than musing. So I want to look at those two words. So we are amused by God rather than musing upon God. Do we know what to be amused is? To be entertained for a short while. It's a light thing. It doesn't last forever. We're partially engaged in it. But when you muse, it's a deep-rooted study and consideration.
My word. Deep consideration.
Deep consideration. So we must move. The time is now demanding that we move from being amused by the things of God.
Yes.
And so when we become, like, we can become amused by all that we're learning now. And as the wind blows, it's gone.
Come on, Auntie.
But when we are musing upon it, when we muse ourselves in God, it goes down to the depth and the core of our our soul, that when the tribulations come, when the trials and the crosses come, we are willing, we are able to stand against the wiles of the enemy.
Yes.
But if all that we do is being amused, we're in problem. We're talking about renewing our minds. We're talking about having the mind of Christ. Whatever it is that we're gonna, that we spend our time on, that's what we're gonna become. That's what we're gonna become. And so we must muse upon God.
And critical to that is that the word muse is the root word of the word music. To muse on something is to allow that thing to literally control your thoughts. And whatsoever control your thoughts is what you become.
And it controls your actions. Whatever controls your thoughts
will control your actions. But if you feel that you don't like this person until Lori, you're going to treat them that way.
Yes.
You're going to treat them that way. No, sir. Yes. Whatever controls your thought is going to control how you behave. Right? And so we will meet. Yes. When we muse upon this thing, careful consideration, deep consideration that we're going to place upon it. So we understand amusement isn't long-lasting. What is it that we want?
Musing.
We want to muse. We want something that is life-changing.
Amusement.
We want something that is life-changing. The Bible reminds us as believers, we're to gaze upon Him. We're to fix our being upon Him. We're to do what? Fix our being upon Him.
Set that's our affections.
Music. Yes, that part there. Set our affections on things above. Our muse should be on things above, not on the earthly thing, the lower base stuff. And so as we look towards God's standard, I'm coming to a close. 5 more minutes? Can I get 5 minutes? So we're looking at the standard of God's man. That is already there. But I just want to coin them in a few words. I may not know all of them. One of them is that the standard of God's mind, the mind of Christ, is that it's a mind that is alive.
Yes.
It's a mind that is alive. It's a mind that is alive. God's mind is alive. Romans 8 verse 6 says, if your thinking is controlled by your sinful self, there is spiritual death.
Yes.
But if your spirit is controlled by the Spirit, there is life and there is peace. Amen. So where the mind of Christ is, there is life. There is life. There's a conscience and a mind that is alive. And so the things that will bring life, because remember, what we think on will be what the attitude and the action that we have. And so when our mind is alive, we will do the things that will bring life to somebody else, as well as our own beings.
Yes.
So John 10:10 also reminds us that He came so that we can do what? Have life.
And have it more.
What kind of life? Abundance life. Right? So this life will become evident in the choices we make. So He came, and that's a fact. How many of us know that He came? He came. Right? But we may not be experiencing the abundance life. Let's go back and look at the choices we have made in life. Because that abundant life is going to manifest unto Lord itself in the choices that we make.
Yes.
In these choices that we make, the mind, the alive mind, will choose the things of God. Will what? Choose the things of God. Will do what? Choose the things of God. And as I say, I'm hearing my mind saying, it kind of sounds ambiguous. Is it sounding that way to you? Because as we say, choose the things of God. What do we mean? Because we may choose to pray, and we consider prayer the things of God. But we may not choose to eat right, like the things of God. Do we see that?
Yes.
No, I want you to talk back to me. Because I know sometimes we get mixed up along the way. We're saying choosing the things of God. So we may pray, but we eat bad. Is that choosing the things of God?
No.
We may read the Bible, but we do what? We don't exercise.
Exercise meaning like cardio and everything.
Exercise what they read.
Exercise, Michael, like your exercise. Yes. Yes. Because those are things that will that are beneficial to God, having His Spirit living in us so we can be effective on planet Earth. We know that that is what is going to help us to live forever and ever and to accomplish more and more and to do His will. So when we say the things of the Lord, I want us to understand how that fits into your everyday life. Because we don't walk around reading the Bible 24 hours, but we walk around making choices every minute. Like when you're on the job and you know that you mustn't teach the people and things that wasn't given to you and those things. That is the word of the Lord in your life.
Yes.
Do we understand that?
Yes. So that word, that says you're to know your
There's no word in the Bible that says so. There's no word in the Bible.
Yes.
We have to set to our affections and things.
That's the word. That's the word. That word to heaven demanded on the earth. That's not fine. But I'm glad that you raised that because a lot of people think it's the word. So we need to know it's not the word. Right? So we see how these things seep in and form our system.
Let's stop us.
Yes.
It is in Colossians 3, verse
3. 3 or 2, one of them.
Colossians 2, verse something. Verse 10. Let's check it.
Find it.
Let's find it.
Look at the Google lady, not looking for a thing to tell us. So pop and kiss over there.
Mesmerize. It's two.
It's two.
It's
verse
two.
Okay, Colossians. Two.
Verse, Colossians 3, verse 2.
So the alive mind, we said, will choose the things of God. The alive mind will join in with the with that thing that came in many years ago that almost changed an entire century, the WWJD. Remember that?
What would Jesus do?
That's the mind of Christ, you know. So there was this community of people who decided that they were going to check themselves orally and activity by activity. Everything that came up to them, that approached them, before they made any action, they were going to ask a question, what would Jesus do? And they were going to do that. That's a renewed mind. You see that? Yes, setting a focus. It's a decision. It's a decision. Everything is embedded in this decision.
But if we don't tear up the blueprint where we decide if we work with,
we have to decide to tear up the blueprint and throw it out.
We make ourselves and chew it up.
Yes.
All right, Daddy, your blueprint we are working.
We have to empty ourselves.
Yes.
Just empty ourselves of all the things. All the things. Let's say that. All the things. Do we understand what that means? All the things. Does that feel nice for you?
No.
Is it feeling nice for you? It's not feeling nice for me and Auntie Lori, because there are some things that are really pretty good things. But I'm hearing the Lord saying that I need to empty my really pretty good things. Really, when I look at them, also, I can't find anything like sin. If I put it through the thing, the sin bell is not going to ring because it's not sin. But it's not what Christ wants for me now, and that makes it bad. That makes it bad. Having the mind of Christ, what would Jesus do?
Boy, it's a church I get too vicious.
When Christ did not know the Lord.
According to what I've prepared here and what I've seen, what I've been studying, is that he had the mind of Christ because he did only Father's will. So Uncle Norris wants me to skip this out and go to the next point. I'll do just that.
No, I didn't hear that before you.
Wait. If there was a point when Christ didn't do Father's will,
did not know.
Because it's relative to I'm trusting your wisdom, but I want to join what you just said.
Yes, go ahead.
Go ahead. All right, cool. So there's a running conversation between my wife and I.
Oh, yes.
There is, it's Romans, right? I think 12. It's what I personally believe. I personally believe that the matured mind, the renewed mind, can test and prove Father's will to the point where you automatically know what the will of the Lord is, and so you come. And if you go on a step up there, you don't need to ask what the will of the Lord is.
Don't need to pray. That's what he's saying. You don't need to pray.
Don't need to ask anything. Because the same way I believe that Christ's mind was so in sync with God's mind, and they think the same thoughts, and so therefore the thought that came into his head was a thought coming from the Father. I think our mind needs to become so renewed that it's 100% Christ's mind. And so we don't need to ask what the Father's will is. And this is the context. Not that we don't need to pray. We don't need to ask his will because our mind is one with his.
I give him 5 stars for that because that's yes, my total belief.
That's what
that
I believe to us.
That we mother, when the mind of Christ is in us, we know what he's saying about any situation.
And we get the phone
at any time, immediately on the spot.
Because until sometimes.
So hold on a minute. So when I said this community of people were doing, what would Jesus do? What were they doing? Training their minds to hear.
That's right.
They were training their minds to get to the place where they could flow freely.
Right. So Auntie, what I'm saying is, if we, so, not warning anybody, they talk about me. When I go and I don't know what to do, it's because I do not have the mind of Christ. When I begin to say, Lord, what do you want me to do? It's because I do not have the mind of Christ. I need to see myself getting.
Maybe not.
No, it's not that
you don't have it.
No.
It's just that in that particular area, it might be a little difficult to accept. That is a major stop. It's a little difficult to accept based on what we're accustomed to. What has been the running norm. And so it's not that we don't know, but it's taking a little more time to break through to us. That this,
We are on the line we're at.
So you're far right. When
yes.
you hear so, when my mind is one with
yes.
Christ's mind,
yes.
then I find myself less be unsure of
yes.
what to do and pondering and wondering and meandering.
Yes.
And I'd be able to look at a situation and say, well, that's the will of the Lord for the situation. That's the mind of the Lord. Because that's my understanding of Romans 11.
Yes.
Renew your mind so that you will be able to test and prove the will of God is good, wholesome, perfect.
Before I see those hands. So let's go back to that. We realize there were a lot of stuff. And as you assessed your own mind, you realize that there was something that you were fully right, center, fully left. But not everything, I would hope that no one of us who are everything over on the left go totally and completely. Right?
Right.
And it's the same thing as we process through our Christian walk. There are some areas of Christ that is a little bit challenging for us to attain to or to grow into, like some. And so guess what? This is where the humility comes. Where we have to be honest, I keep using that word, there has to be this level of honesty, autocratic, honesty, where we know within ourselves that I don't have it in this area yet. And rather than fighting it, let it go. And allow those that we know get there to do it until we're able to catch up.
Amen.
But when we don't know and we're headstrong, we cause what?
Casualty,
chaos. Okay. So we must be honest with ourselves to know where we're at in this thing. And if you know that you don't really at that place where you have that authority, auntie, and where you know your mind is, your mind not letting you go in that particular issue to deal with it, let it go. And listen and learn and go repent and pray. Nobody has to know you're working on it now. You're just silent and you go away in your quiet time and you say, God, you know I'm struggling in this area. Don't fight the individual. Don't make the battle become. Where is the battle? Mental battlefield we have. So don't make the battle become a person. Do we understand that? Okay, I saw several hands.
I'm going to go back to Jesus. Jesus spent more time in prayer with the Father
than what he spent in manifestation of what he was sent to do. It goes back to relationship. Even acquiring the mind of Christ requires relationship. It is in prayer that all of what was manifested, it was already revealed in prayer. And even as you journey with your relationship with God, you will realize that a lot of your day-to-day activities can be manifested like that, where you would have already encountered it in the spirit before it was manifested in the flesh. And that is a serious journey to walk. And that's the journey to walk. Let's encounter it first with the Father, and then let the manifestation of it thereof be in the flesh after. And so Jesus knew exactly what to do. He knew that the Jairus' daughter was going to come alive. There were many people that died during his time, but he knew the ones that were going to come back alive. He knew the Father. It's about knowing God. When you know God, you become him. It's about that. And this can only happen in relationship. And relationship is built with you and God. It is built with you and God. You do that. You find
choice. Choice.
You choose it.
Yes.
You.
Amen. Clap for Auntie Ella.
Let's thank God. Let's thank God cannot redeem these things.
Oh my God.
Amen.
And so, God, he wants us to come into that technology. You know that?
Yes.
He wants us to come into that technology.
Wow.
He wants us to have his mind.
Yes.
He wants us to be able to legislate the way he would legislate in this time, in the now time. And as Uncle Norris says, you know, a lot of time we use the going to pray about it as an excuse. Because the Lord knows that we ain't going to pray about it. Because we know that we don't have the right mind and attitude towards it. But at least it gives take the person off me for a season of time. And so guess what? Can we have the mind of Christ? Can we set upon that this week?
Amen.
We're going to set upon having the mind of Christ.
This life.
This life. This life. Amen? And so I'm going to stop here. I promise you some points, but I think that we have had it. And so write down your homework. I hope you can do the homework without me finishing. Yes. This is what we're going to work upon this week. So as we do this research, and as we come into this, this is how we will communicate with each other. We'll post it in the WhatsApp, we will talk, we will have it going, we'll ask questions, we will... We'll call up each other, we will, you know, we'll repent, we'll pray, we'll study the Word. That there are constantly all types of messages being sent to us from all different places. But we must be conscientious for the rest of our lives of this very important thing that God sends us messages as well. There are messages in the world going out consistently, but God sends us messages as well. Right?